Hello, everyone, and welcome to the SAG-AFTRA podcast. I'm Duncan Crabtree Ireland, National Executive Director of SAG-AFTRA.
And I'm Ben Whitehair, Executive Vice President of SAG-AFTRA.
On this special episode, we're going to highlight two major organizing stories that should inspire and encourage all of us to keep fighting for unions in America. On-air talent from both KVEA Telemundo 52 in Los Angeles and WAMU in Washington, D.C. joined forces with SAG-AFTRA to successfully unionize.
Yes, they did. These incredible stories are part of a continuing trend of unionizing efforts across the country, and I'm very much looking forward to hearing the details of what happened.
To walk us through this exciting yet sometimes tumultuous process, we're joined by Dunia Elvir, a television journalist and producer who works as an anchor for TV station Telemundo 52 in Los Angeles.
Also joining us is Jordan Pascale, transportation reporter for WAMU 885.
Both of our guests were instrumental in the organizing efforts. Welcome, Jordan and Dunia. We were hoping that you might start us off on this podcast episode by telling us a little bit about the different stations that you work for and why you chose to unionize. Jordan, why don't we start with you?
Yeah, sure. Well, WAMU is DC's kind of local NPR station. We have a national show, 1A, that goes out all across the country, and a regional newsroom that covers a lot of in-depth issues in DC and Virginia and Maryland. But the station really kind of started to progress and professionalize more in about like last 10, 15 years. But that really brought a lot of growing pains for us. So we had a lot of reasons to unionize. We had a management that said that they were really focused on recruiting and retaining a diverse staff. But then we had people of color, you know, saying that we're mistreated in the office and they were leaving the station left and right. And so, you know, we wanted an inclusive workplace and making sure that happened. We had kind of an unfortunate incident of kind of a serial harasser in the office of women, and that wasn't properly taken care of. He wasn't fired. And so we wanted accountability for that. We just had a lot of internal reckonings. And meanwhile, you know, DC, like LA, I'm sure the cost of living is, you know, astronomical and getting worse. And so we wanted better wages and transparency in hiring and making sure that, you know, people were coming in and making a livable wage. And then, you know, during the middle of our organizing were the pandemic, the 2020 protests, January 6th in DC, which brought a whole host of concerns about what situations reporters were going into. Editors did provide us with bulletproof vests on January 6th and you know, stuff after that, gas masks, safety equipment. But, you know, that's not always guaranteed unless it's in a contract. And so we wanted to make sure and kind of force future editors to make sure that those things were provided too. But we really saw unionization as a kind of a path to accountability and a seat at the table and codifying some of these processes that will be valuable in the future.
Yeah, I think that's really a good representation of these things that I think often people take for granted, just assuming like, well, of course, those things would be protected or you'd have those things taken care of. And sadly, that's not always the case. And I love what you've highlighted of some just really, you know, I think anybody can resonate. Oh my gosh, I'm not safe in my workspace physically. I need appropriate, fair pay. You know, these, again, what I would call fundamental basics of a working environment, and that, you know, a union is very much a path to making that happen.
Yeah. And I mean, how else are you going to get that voice in the workplace? So there's so many workplaces that really don't, you know, they may not be malevolent, but they don't provide that voice for the people who really know the most in a lot of ways about what's going on in their work environment. Dunia, can you share with us a little bit about your perspective on why your group chose to unionize and sort of what that experience was like?
Yeah, I worked in Telemundo since 1990. I've seen a lot of changes, and I understand that KVEA specifically, Telemundo 52 in LA, tried to unionize probably three times before, and it was not successful. When this was happening, I was in the network, so I was not involved. I remember right before COVID, we were under a very tyrannical management. This management that we have, it's not normal. Why are we fighting out there for the rights of undocumented people? Why are we become the voice of the voiceless and we leave our voice mute? So that's why we decided to do something. At the end of the day, it's just being hypocritical with ourselves. You know, we are under this pressure, abuse. It was very disturbing. It's something that you will never think happened to a reporter, an anchor, a photographer, and the destructive behavior was just getting worse. It was growing. We got lucky and management changed, and we have a great team now. And that was one of the things when we talked to my first point of contact was the attorney. I called her and I told her, look, we have great management, but he's not here forever. What if he's such a great person, he's going to be promoted. And then whoever comes after me, pretty much I'm going to retire in a few more years. We want them to stay with some set of protections and to feel comfortable. We started before COVID and we had two organizers that were helping us under those really rough situations. Everyone was afraid. Everyone was petrified. I was petrified too, that if they find out, they'll fire everybody because it happened before. People saw reporters and anchors being fired in the past. I believe in the early 2000s or late 1990s was the last time they tried, and like six or seven of them got fired. So then after COVID, everything got stopped and then we went into it again. But it was mainly because of that. You know, why are you defending people with your reports and you're not defending yourself? So, and it gets to a point that you have to speak up.
Yeah, I mean, we've definitely seen examples, not only the one that you mentioned, Dunia, but also in other organizing campaigns that we've done recently where employers haven't been good partners and employers have tried to retaliate against workers for exercising their federally protected right to organize and become part of a union. And so when that happens, you know, it does require all of us to sort of stand together and speak out and fight against that. And we've had those situations reversed by the National Labor Relations Board, had people reinstated and got back pay, things like that when employers take that attitude and approach. And it's always disappointing when they do, because both of you are great examples of how the reasons for organizing really have to do with making a better workplace that's ultimately better for the employer as well. But I think they often don't see that. And I was thinking that that's like the perfect segue into us talking a little bit about what the organizing process is like. And in SAG-AFTRA, we sort of see it as a three-step or a three-phase process. And that first phase is building support and making sure that there is sufficient supermajority support within the potential unit so that we know that there really is a strong desire amongst the people working in that station or in that workplace to be represented by SAG-AFTRA. And so that can involve, you know, creating an organizing committee, that can involve us working together to get signatures on cards, it can involve education and really talking with workers about what the union can do for them, how they can be protected during the organizing process, and what their expectations can be about bargaining that might occur after a successful unionizing campaign. How did that play out for both of you? Like, what was your experience with that first phase of the organizing process?
We were all afraid. We were all petrified. I'm going to be honest with you. We didn't want to let those cards go. So what we did, we made a deal with SAG-AFTRA. We'll get the cards and we won't give them to you until we have, at least we were looking for 80%. That's where we put our numbers. And we work it together as a team. And we make sure that we had all the cards before we gave the package complete. And I know that's not the typical process, because I read a lot about it and we were talking to a lot of people, but that was the way for our team to feel comfortable, feeling after all they went through. It's like the victim of domestic violence, you know, you grab a key and you throw a key a little bit too hard and the person feels I'm going to get hit again. And maybe they're not going to get hit again. But the situation was so intense with firing people and such a tyrannical management, and also with the first round of not making it happen and feeling naked. So for us, it worked. Keeping everything, give it to SAG-AFTRA when we had at least 80% and move forward when we had 80%. That's how we decided. And making the conversations, each person had one or two, and we were making the group a little bigger. And that's how we did it, and very quietly and fast. I understand this takes time. We decided to go into a fast pace. I mean, by week four, we had almost everybody on board. By week six, we had, you know, a lot of people committed to go and drive around. We wanted to get the cards in person. I know they're doing them electronically now, but people didn't want to do it electronically either because of the previous experience. So we were just driving all over from Orange County to the Valley, everywhere, because people were afraid also to bring the cards to work. So it was like a maratónico, you know, it was like a marathon, just running, trying to get everything fast. And we created our own idea from what we learned in round one. And we said, no, we're going to take over. We're going to do this, like that, and like that. And these are the dates. And if we don't get a result by then, so we move back. And that's how we did it. We pretty much, you know, just were fast.
Well, I think that highlights how really every organizing campaign is a little different. Every organizing campaign has to be designed for the specific workers and workplace that it's connected with. And I think Dunia, it also really points out the courage that's required. And, you know, I think all of us here at SAG-AFTRA are constantly in admiration of the workers who step forward and help make these organizing campaigns happen, because the changes that they help create for their fellow employees can be really significant. I think I'd mentioned to you earlier that I was involved with the Telemundo organizing campaign for the telenovela actors, which were primarily in Miami. And the result of that organizing campaign, which had a lot in common with what you were just describing, you know, changed people's lives completely to where they didn't have health insurance or any retirement before, and now they do, or they didn't have any, in that example, they didn't have any residuals, and now they do. They didn't have any guaranteed minimum salaries, and now they do. So I think, you know, that courage can really pay off, but it's, I know it's a really scary process, especially at the beginning sometimes.
Yeah, I just wanted to acknowledge you and your coworkers and anybody who's gone through this, because, you know, the fear of retaliation or these other things, to me, if nothing else, highlights the importance of unions, because that's the type of thing that workers shouldn't be, have to be afraid of. And I understand that that's very much a reality. And I think the tenacity and solidarity of the workers on the ground in the workplace coming together and collectively demanding, you know, fair treatment and fair wages and all the rest, to me, is at the core of unionism, and a good reminder that that really is what gives unions their power and their strength.
Absolutely. Jordan, what was it like for you? What was your experience with that first phase of the process?
Yeah, I think the fear, I totally identified with, you know, feeling that uncertainty, the fear of, you know, retaliation. It took a long time. I mean, we started early 2019-ish, you know, talking to SAG-AFTRA and trying to figure out, you know, get a small group of people that were of the same mindset, just to kind of learn about the unionization process. None of us had been in one before. We had certainly had friends in, you know, other broadcast areas or newspapers. There was such a wave of unionization and journalism over the last couple of years that we did feel a little bit emboldened and felt like we weren't alone, which really helped. You know, it took time to build a database of everyone's contact info. We had engineering departments, we had hosts, we had reporters, we had producers, we had all these different people that we didn't know everyone. And so, you know, even just getting cell phone numbers and emails and all that stuff took a ton of time. And so by the time we got everybody on board, it did take probably about a year. But, you know, the folks that the organizers at SAG were so helpful, so informational on everything that we had no idea about the process or how it works or anything. So just a really great resource that we didn't feel alone through it, which was great.
Very happy to hear that. And I certainly have heard for years, you know, organizing and what does that mean, right? In the actual process, which, as you all talked about, you know, starting with galvanizing support within the workforce, working with SAG-AFTRA, you know, getting a sense of what the actual issues and legal issues are. And then from there, curious to hear any insights, starting with Jordan, on sort of that next phase of, you know, going public, seeing if the employers will voluntarily recognize the union. Certainly the goal that the other side of the table says, yeah, we're happy to sit down and have this conversation. Certainly that's the goal, and curious to hear about what that looked like on the ground for you.
Yeah, well, it takes about a year and a half to go public. Two great feelings in this process is announcing it on Twitter and having so much support from not only people locally, but you know, all across the country, which was very cool to see other unions having that solidarity, cheering you on, that sort of thing. We did not get voluntarily recognized. It took a vote, and I think it was 98% or 99%, you know, signed cards said, yes, I'm in. And that was great. That was December 2020. So we were very much in full swing of pandemic, but it did take us a little bit to get from that organizing stage to the you know, signing cards and everything.
Dunia, what about you? How has that second part of the process been in your experience?
Just like Jordan explained, it was like a relief, you know, after when we saw everything going public. And I have to say, the people here at work were also supportive, you know, when we saw all these papers posted all over the walls, and we read in social media, and it was like a relief. Okay, it's there. Ya salió el gato de la caja. So the cat's out of the box. There's no more secrecy, because it's very intense to be thinking, especially when you've seen it happening. It's different when you hear from somebody else. I've been part of Telemundo, like I said, since 1990. And even though I was not in the departments that were doing it, you see people leaving and you're like, what is going on? What happened here? So many of us have been here for a long time. We were thinking, what if it happens to us? So seeing everything going, in our case, like I said, we decided that we wanted it really fast. We didn't want it to go and have cards expire again. So it went so fast that in a way, we didn't have time to think, what if this doesn't work? It had to work. We have to make it happen. And we got the dates and everything went down in less than 6 months from day one to, you know, the day of the, let's see, Julio, September, October, November, December. Yeah, less than 6 months from the moment that we got the first phone call to the moment that the election went.
So both of you had elections. Neither of those units were voluntarily recognized. How did it feel when the election tabulation was finally done and you had these results that really validated the fact that all of, or that your colleagues really joined with you and believe in this unionizing effort? I mean, what was that like the day that you got the, you know, that the votes were tabulated and you got the results?
We were all together. We did it via Zoom. Everyone participated. The whole team was there. So listening to all these ballots being, you know, counted and the way we won, it was pretty pretty good. It was only one no. Everything was yes, 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 yes. So it was a relief. It was like, okay, this team is together.
Does that resonate with you, Jordan?
Yeah, I mean, we, you know, you see it, the tallies, you know, getting marked and everything. And it ended up being 65 yeses. When you get unanimous, I mean, that just really says that we all see what's going on, the problems, and we all are willing to kind of like go all in and work on it together and as a union and bargain the contract and everything. And it's just those bright moments really make up for all of the, you know, meetings after work that take time, or, you know, the conversation. Like it's almost a second job sometimes to, you know, organize and do bargaining sessions and all this stuff. But those moments of unity really do matter a lot, and it feels great.
I'm emotional hearing about it. It's just so powerful to me when, yeah, these communities of people come together and say, hey, collectively as human beings, we are united in making sure that, again, we have these fundamental, what I think increasingly society sees as like, yeah, these should be basic rights of the workplace, but they're not. And it often takes a union to come in and say, hey, we're going to demand that. What I think, you know, when you ask most people, hey, do you think it would be reasonable that people can be safe in the workplace? Do you think it's reasonable that, you know, they could support their families based on hard work, and that regardless of your gender or ethnicity or sexual orientation, that you get paid the same fair wage. I think most people go, well, yeah, that makes sense. That sounds fair, but it's not always happening. And that, to me, is why it's so important that people band together to make sure that we get those things. And unions are often the best mechanism to do that.
You know, I grew up in Nebraska where, you know, it wasn't a Boston or New York or somewhere where you saw unionization in kind of the, or, you know, a Detroit or something like that, where unions were so strong. And so I got a real education on what all unions brought us over the past 100 years. And it's great to kind of see that upswing of, you know, unionization happening again.
Yeah, it's a great reminder. You know, I from the same people who brought you The Weeknd and child labor laws, now coming additional protections. I think it is helpful to remember that, like, hey, that's how we got those things. And so the next things that we want as a workforce, this is the way to do that.
That's so true. Of course, after both of you and the rest of the groups there were excited about the results, comes phase three, which is bargaining the first contract. And that can be a whole new challenge after you've sort of successfully navigated the organizing phase, you've had the big win with the election, and now it's time to sit down with employers who sometimes are supportive and ready to work with you and sometimes aren't. So maybe, Jordan, you want to start first and tell us a little bit about the first contract negotiation process as you experience it.
It was fascinating. I'd never sat in on a negotiation or anything like it. A lot of it was on Zoom because, you know, peak pandemic, but took about a year and a half of going back and forth. And, you know, it was a values conversation of what we think is important. You know, we're a news station, but we're technically owned by American University. So we kind of had an interesting problem where we were talking to people that were academics and, you know, we're thinking about a university, but not thinking about what reporters and what newsmaker, you know, editors and producers were doing. And so, you know, a lot of it was kind of establishing, like, here's what we do and here's what we need from you. And so, you know, it's a lot of back and forth. It's a lot of trying to figure out how to approach things, what to pitch, where to agree on, where to really push back. But a lot of hours, there were times that, you know, we had complete breakdown of neither of us could kind of agree on stuff, and take some time and try to figure out a different way to approach wages or, you know, different protections and stuff. And so it's arduous, but it's a fascinating process. We had a couple people on the negotiating committee, but anyone that's in a union, I definitely recommend, you know, sitting in on one just to see what a negotiation looks like. I think it's very valuable to see what that's like.
Yeah. And Dunia, have you all started your first contract bargaining yet, or is it about to begin? Where does it stand for you?
Well, we have a date. So right now, pretty much what we're doing is just preparing for that with the bargaining committee and our attorney. And it's like, you know, just like Jordan said, it's fascinating and so interesting. And we're trying to stay as positive as possible and think, okay, that treatment here, it's been so good that we hope to see that on the table too. And we hope to see that, you know, how do you say, translated into reasonable situations.
I imagine it's exciting too, to think that after this process, you know, now is a chance to really be able to bring forward those concerns that sort of motivated a lot of people to be part of and to support organizing, and to say, now we're going to look to see something put into place that really addresses those concerns. You know, and I don't know about you, but I always come to these things with an optimistic approach, which is hopefully now, having gone through that process, the employer will really see that there is a need for some action to be taken in these areas to address the concerns that their workers have. You know, in both of your cases, overwhelmingly, either by a unanimous vote or almost unanimous vote, demonstrated our real issues, you know?
Yeah, I tend to be optimistic in that as well. And you know, we know that that doesn't always happen and that sometimes other actions need to be taken. But I certainly am of the belief, and I hope that the employers writ large in today's economy continue to see that better work happens when people have these kinds of protections. You know, to me, it makes sense as a business to say, hey, you know what? If my people are happy to come to work, if they feel safe, if they have the protections they need, if they can be free of harassment and accepted and, you know, supported in their job, like they're going to give better work. The businesses are going to do better. And, you know, for any worker, I want my business to do well. You know, as a performer myself, I want every production I'm involved with to be the most successful production in the history of the film and television industry, you know, and I think we all share that collective goal. And the more that we can have those fundamentals in place, the better the product is going to be.
Yeah, that's definitely true. I wonder for both of you, were you confident that the vote was going to come in from the very beginning of the process, or did you have doubts? And how did you sort of keep your energy going and keep your enthusiasm going during any sort of, I mean, every process has a bit of a roller coaster to it, so I'm sure there must have been some downs as well as some ups. So how do you keep your enthusiasm and your confidence going during those times?
We used to talk every day off work just about it. And we kept very, real questions. Hey, I'm freaking out today. Hey, I'm afraid today. Hey, I don't think we should keep going with this. I think we're crazy. Hey, I have kids. I have this. I have that. Well, chill, stuff like that. One another, you know, or, hey, this is looking good. Hey, I see so-and-so today that it looks a little down. What do you think is it? Hey, I don't like what so-and-so is doing. I don't like what so-and-so, it's the way it's behaving. Well, let's focus and one. We're one now. We cannot be nitpicking what so-and-so is doing that you don't like. We have to just keep motivating everybody and remind that person that whatever they do is going to impact the entire team, not only them. So let's keep everybody rolling into the same positive path, like come to work on your time. Do not take advantage of different situations. Like I said, our situation, I think, has been very, very peculiar for many different reasons. But within that peculiarity, we needed to keep the process and the rhythm as simple and united as possible, like if it was any other unit. So we just kept talking to everybody every day and circling on the weekends. Then again, hey, how was the week? Hey, how do you feel? Stuff like that to keep everybody feeling like, okay, we are the KVEA family, but we are the on-air talent family.
Mm. Yes.
And make them feel, okay, I got your back. And that really worked for us. Talking to one another in a daily basis. If someone didn't answer, a text, a voice message, something. But we had that communication and we still have it. We still have it because we're still technically in the process. And that's what it's been working for us.
You know, you'll probably always have it because, I mean, that's part of, you know, having that union in the workplace is all of you talking together so that you can collectively have your voice heard. And I don't know. I mean, it feels to me like the organizing campaigns I've been involved in, the workers who are involved in them, and even new employees who come on after that process, there really is a community that's built as part of that that sticks around.
Yeah, I'm curious what types of changes have either of you seen? Like what's the light at the end of the tunnel? What are the things that you're seeing that have been different after this process?
Well, I think just consistency and also knowing what's ahead. I mean, the contract is 46 pages that we can point to and say, this is what we're getting, that, you know, we're for sure getting 2.5%, you know, percent raises in addition to merit, that, you know, if there is a discrepancy, that there's a grievance process, that, you know, we put in things where you have to put out reports on hiring and how they're doing on DEI efforts. I think there's a lot of things that basically just provide kind of an accountability system where, you know, the workers can hold management responsible to what they say they're going to do. So I think that's, you know, monetary, obviously, really big one. But, you know, some of those guardrails, I think, are one of the major benefits that we've seen. We just got done with our contract in August, so we're still kind of feeling out some stuff and working through kind of that new contract feel. But I think that's kind of some of the things that we're most grateful for.
In our case, we still don't have a contract. We are fairly new. Like I said, we had two organizers, the first round, one organizer, the second round. The first round went and all the cards expired and we couldn't continue. We couldn't move forward. they had a lot of changes, I believe, and we didn't know what was going to happen. So this time we barely started in probably July 17 was the first conversation. And the election just passed in January. So we don't have a contract yet. But like I said, the management changed. So in our case, it's very peculiar because if we talk about the treatment, it's there now. Everything that you're supposed to have, we have it now. But even though we have it and we have a very respectful place to work and very considerate, and we actually have unlimited days off. I mean, I was cracking up. I'm like, we are unionized now and we have 365 days, sick days, and nobody asks you anything. But it's still, you know, we still don't think, okay, we're going to just back up, because we know eventually there's going to be, again, people. It's just people making these decisions. We have great people right now. Who knows if these people leave, and we want to leave things in place. It's fairly new for us. We don't have the contract, so I don't have a clear answer for that because we're in the process. But it seems like the process has been very smooth. It seems like SAG-AFTRA and the employer are working in good faith. That we can see it from both ends.
Well, I know the process can come with lots of hurdles and challenges. Both of you have spoken about a number of those. And, you know, I deeply acknowledge you and anyone out there listening who's gone through these types of efforts or is thinking about it, because I understand that it's not always a smooth road, but clearly, you know, hearing from both of you, just so very worth it. Any final thoughts? Dunia, we'll start with you. Final message to anybody out there who is considering doing their own unionizing efforts. Any words of wisdom, advice, or encouragement?
Just keep in mind, at the end of the day, we're only people. And like people, you're not going to like everybody. You're not going to see eye to eye with everybody. But everybody is looking for the well-being of the entire team. So if we come to terms that I don't have to like the 65 members involved, but I have to realize that we all have a common desire or the same goal, then that will help you see the principle before the personality and move forward. Because I realize that in many different situations in life that we all get involved, there's always that person that you don't see eye to eye, but that doesn't mean you don't need that person. It doesn't mean that that person doesn't need you. We all need one another as a team. So if we remember that you don't have to like everybody, but we have to work together towards the same goal, then your unit process, the unionizing is going to be stronger and you're going to be able to move forward. I think that's key, because sometimes we go into, let's keep things organized. Let's keep things, you know, clear calendars, this, blah, blah, blah. But for me, it's very important to realize that we're only people. Sometimes I don't like my brothers, you know, but they're still going to be my brothers. Mm. And that's the best example I can give you. I'm going to love them no matter what. Mm. I'm going to be like a mother for them because they're my brothers. So this is my team. We're not going to like everybody, but we're going to have to love everybody, especially when we're moving towards the same goal.
Mm, that's powerful. Jordan, what about you?
Yeah, I think I learned a lot of patience during this process. I think it's beneficial for everyone to, you know, educate themselves on the process, what to expect, what unions can and can't do. You know, I think a lot of people think it's a silver bullet for everything, and it's probably not going to be. It's going to address a lot of issues, but it might not, you know, address your pet issue or that sort of thing. And in negotiations, you know, same thing. You're not going to get everything, but at the end of the day, we are so much better off than where we were when we started off in 2019. And we've lost a lot of members that have gone on to new jobs or have been promoted to management, that sort of thing. A lot of turnover, but, you know, not only is it great for us right now, that you know, the 55-ish members that we have, it's going to be there for future generations of people that haven't even started working here yet, that young reporters moving to DC for the first time. I know they're going to be making $70,000 and you know, having a livable wage, and that they're going to be having these protections and, you know, routes for grievances and other protections, that's going to last long term. And I think that's the biggest thing, is look at this as a big long term goal, is how we can you know, improve things, not just now, but years in the future.
Wow. I think that is both of you, that's incredibly inspiring. We have been incredibly privileged to be joined by both of you. Dunia Elvir, Jordan Pascale, thank you so much for being with us today on the SAG-AFTRA podcast. And I think your words are going to really inspire a bunch of our members and future members who might be listening to this podcast.
Hear, hear. Such a pleasure. Very much appreciate both of you, not only for all the work that you've done, but for coming and sharing your stories from the trenches of what it's taken to get here and the work that you're continuing to do. And to anybody listening who's in a similar place or looking to be, hopefully you can be as inspired as I am about what's possible. So thank you both for being with us today.
Thank you very much for having us.
Thanks so much. It was a great conversation.
For more information and resources from today's episode, please visit sagaftra.org/podcast. And if you gained any value from today's podcast, please consider sharing it with someone else who might find value. If you haven't already, please tap that subscribe button and take a few seconds to rate and review this episode. And please follow SAG-AFTRA on our official social media channels. That's @SAG-AFTRA on all major platforms, including YouTube.
The SAG-AFTRA podcast is produced and edited by Aaron Goddard and John Small. Supervising producers are Pamela Greenwalt, Shira Reich, and Michael McNulty, with production and marketing support from Damon Romine, Jolie Coconte, Delaney Howard, Margot Giordano, Joe Molgado, Mei Wong, Bernadine Robbins, and Maria Cabezas. The podcast is hosted by Ben Whitehair and me, yours truly, Duncan Crabtree Ireland.